All right, good afternoon. Yesterday's COVID report was hard. And I'm going to admit up front today, a little emotional and a little raw. Seeing nearly 5,000 cases and 65 Kentuckians that we lost in just one day's report is tough. We've been in days like this, actually, there only been 2 days with more cases in the entire pandemic. But to know we had the third highest day of cases and lost that many people at a time where it is entirely preventable just hits you on an entirely different level. We are, as a state, now in a critical situation. And in fact, we've now moved to uncharted territory. Let's talk about hospitalizations. Hospitalizations have increased every day without exception for the past 42 days, from 239 on July 14th to 2,074 on August 25th. 42 straight days of more Kentuckians being so sick with COVID, they end up in the hospital. Let's remind you of some more statistics that start from July 14th. On that day, we had 60 people in an intensive care unit fighting for their lives against COVID-19. As of yesterday, we have 549. On July 14th, we had 25 people on a ventilator. That's when you're praying for survival. As of yesterday, we now have 338. On July 14th, our positivity rate was 3.81%. And in fact, just weeks before, it had gotten down to 1.79%. Today, it's at a record high of 13.16%, the highest in any time since we have had adequate testing to truly get a positivity rate. Unfortunately, those aren't the only records that we've broken recently. We have not just had hospitalizations increase every single day for the last 42 days. We've set a new record for hospitalizations for 5 straight days. Before the Delta variant, our record number of hospitalizations, this is even with the Alpha variant or before we had vaccines, before we knew how well masks worked. So before the Delta variant, our record number of hospitalizations was 1,817. That was on December 17th, 2020. And let me tell you, December was a really deadly year last year for Kentuckians. But on August 21st, we broke that record at 1,841 hospitalizations. And today, this is even before the numbers come in later this afternoon, 2,074 Kentuckians are in the hospital with this virus. My point is, with all these numbers, we're not just critical, we are in uncharted territory. We've been fighting this virus for more than 18 months. We've never been where we are today. And as horrible as last year's surge was, and it was awful, we're never in a position where doctors worry they need to choose between treating a patient who can't breathe because of COVID or treat a patient who's bleeding out because of a car accident. But that is the strain that our hospitals are under. But the difference in between right now, uncharted territory, and where we were before, which in terms of hospitalizations and ICU and ventilators, as bad as it was, is not as bad as it is right now. The difference is we know how to win. We know how to prevent this devastation. We know how to free up space in our emergency rooms for those that are in car accidents or have strokes. Like a member of my family, have a really bad fall and need that emergency treatment. We know how well masks work in ways that we can prevent the spread and ultimately have fewer people that are sick in need of hospitalization. The difference between now and uncharted dangerous territory and before is we have the answer. They are these safe and effective vaccines. Full FDA approval for one, the gold standard, the same studies that they have done for the 12 vaccines you got to take before sixth grade that we have all had, more than 30 plus shots for them. And we know while we are getting everybody vaccinated, there's a really easy way to practice the golden rule, to love your neighbor as yourself, and that's to wear a mask. You know, if we boil it down and say, if I knew somebody in my county was going to die today, might not know them, but if I wore a mask today, it would prevent that from happening. I certainly hope everybody in this Commonwealth would put on that mask. Now, that's what we face. That's the question every single morning. And I hope, I pray, people who haven't gotten the vaccine, that something will touch their heart and they will get it. And for everybody else, we'll stop the silly arguments and do something that public health has been doing for decades. Why? To prevent the spread of infection, which is exactly what we're facing. We've shown a lot of videos about our struggling hospitals, and we're going to talk about some of those today. We've had a lot in the East. Some of the hardest hit are in the East. But we've been hit hard all across the Commonwealth. So we're going to start with the message on the importance of vaccines. And you're going to see the exhaustion that has hit all of our people. From Dr. Rao, he is the general surgery doctor at Baptist Health Madisonville.
My name is Mohan Rao. I have been a general surgeon in West Kentucky, specifically Madisonville, for 35 years. I have had the privilege to take care of the people of West Kentucky and Hopkins County in particular, and I have truly enjoyed being a doctor in this part of the state, period. The last couple of years have been very difficult. Last year was extremely difficult taking care of patients with COVID. We learned a lot because we'd never seen anything like this before. I thought last year that we had seen the worst of it, especially with the introduction of vaccines. And once we all got vaccinated, I thought that a lot of this would go away. Unfortunately, it's come back, and it's come back pretty ugly. It's come back with a vengeance. And I'm not going to tell you that getting vaccinated is going to keep you from getting sick 100% of the time. What I am going to say is that as somebody who believes in individual liberties, which I do, I'm vaccinated. And I did that for the protection of myself, for the protection of my family, and for the protection of my patients. I strongly recommend that people get it. To the nurses and the physicians and my fellow physicians and technicians and everybody, people who clean the floors, people who make our food, people who do everything, I thank everybody for their service. I'm getting tired of wearing this, and I think everybody else is too. I'd like to go out to dinner and not have to eat outside, even if it's in the rain. I'd like my patients to get better. I'd like not to walk down into the ICU, a 20-bed ICU, and see 19 out of the 20 beds occupied by people on ventilators, some of them young people. I'd like all that to go away. What we need is we need for everybody to kind of step up and help us out the best way they know how. And that's all we're asking. It's hard to come to work, but not impossible, and it's still a privilege to come here. But it'd be really nice to be able to do the things for people that I've been trained to do and try to help people the best way I know how.
And I think you can see and feel the emotion, the weariness, and the trauma that our healthcare heroes have gone through. He said, I'd like to walk down to the ICU and not see 19 out of 20 of the beds filled, with almost all of them on ventilators, many young people. Next, we're going to move to Henderson, where Dr. Dennis Beck, Interim Chief Administrative Officer at Deaconess Henderson Hospital, which I stopped by just the other day, is going to give us an update on what they're seeing.
Good morning. My name is Dennis Beck, and I'm the Interim Chief Administrative Officer of Deaconess Henderson Hospital and also a physician. Today, I want to give a status update on the current situation of our patients and our capacity here in Henderson, Kentucky. The crisis is real. Our patient volumes are higher than they ever have been in any summertime period in the history of our hospital and our health system. We're working the problem. Our heroes in our healthcare are flexing, they're adapting, and they're improvising, working with each other to increase capacity, increase throughput, and at the same time maintain the top quality care that we're known for. What can you do? The most important thing is to encourage vaccination. If you know somebody, if you know people at your church, at your schools who still are hesitant, help them get informed, talk to them, listen to them, understand their concerns, but tell them and repeat to them over and over again that it's a real problem we're suffering with right now. Our capacities are high, patients are sick, and patients are dying without need. We want to thank Governor Beshear for visiting our hospital yesterday. It really lifted up the spirits of all of our healthcare workers, everything from a flower bouquet to the proclamation and the time spent visiting and talking to our frontline healthcare heroes. So let me remind everybody, please get vaccinated. Please engage in social distancing, mask wearing. Hang in there for the long haul because we're going to get through this together as a family like I know we can. Thank you very much.
And what do we hear out of Henderson? Patient volumes higher than they've ever been at that time of year in that hospital. Patients are sick. Patients are dying for no need. And what you hear from every healthcare hero when asked what you can do for them, get vaccinated. All right. Finally, we're going to hear from Courtney Fales. And Courtney, I hope I pronounced your last name correctly, and maybe Fales. And Sean Kathman, both registered nurses at St. Elizabeth Healthcare in Northern Kentucky.
Work right now has definitely picked up in the last few months. When the numbers started rising again, you know, myself and my colleagues, we kind of got nervous because we knew what it was like last fall when we had such a high level of patients and we were already, you know, trying to recuperate from all the stress we had been going through with that.
It just felt like you could never catch up. There was just a surplus of patients coming in that were very sick. I mean, we had an entire nursing home come in at one time.
Now, with the Delta variant, those numbers are picking back up again, so we're really trying to work towards lowering them back to a level that's more manageable.
There's a lot of factors. Hospitals are being filled all over the country. I would say most of our patients right now are unvaccinated folks. Patients that we've had that have been vaccinated, they've been admitted for maybe a day just for observation and have been discharged within a day or two, not nearly as sick as the folks that are unvaccinated. There's been several that I had very great relationships with that did not make it through, and I was one of the last people that they saw and had a conversation with, and that sticks with you. It's very hard.
It is definitely exhausting to see more and more patients come in that are unvaccinated and that are really struggling. We have to work twice as hard. It takes more staff. It takes more, you know, bodies to keep these patients stable. It just makes me really want people to get vaccinated because a lot of the people that I see right now struggling are the ones that have not gotten the vaccine.
Please consider if vaccination is on your mind, do it. Getting vaccinated is the number one priority right now, and that's what's going to be our shield to not only help yourselves but help others. We were called heroes a year ago, and a lot of the times heroes do things that they don't want to do, but it's for the greater good.
Well, thank you to Sean and Courtney, St. Elizabeth, for that. You know, Sean talking about how it sticks with you. That's the trauma that our folks are going through. And again, they don't have to go through the amount of trauma that they're experiencing at the moment if you get vaccinated. As they reported, our hospitals have been hit and hit very hard. As of today, 1/3 of all of our hospitals across Kentucky, 32 of 96, are reporting critical staffing shortages. Folks, that is a big problem. It's hospitals that are treating patients much sicker than they normally treat, that have people on ventilators, even though they don't have an ICU because there is no place to take them or there is no group that can transport them. Ohio County Hospital has had to expand their emergency department to handle the significant increase in COVID patients. Taylor Regional, Campbellsville, had 4 ventilated patients within 5 hours and had to place 2 more on ventilators right after that. Think about it. That doesn't happen in that hospital. Caldwell County Hospital had patients in emergency rooms for 3 days on a ventilator, unable to transfer. There's no ICUs in that hospital. Monroe County Hospital, 2 ventilated patients in the ER, unable to transfer, no ICUs there. Jackson Purchase, 10 patients in the emergency department, waiting to try to get moved to a higher acuity bed. And the hospitals that we have mentioned before that have hit so hard, St. Clair in disaster mode. I'm not sure that's ever happened in Kentucky, but a hospital has gone into disaster mode. At least I can't remember it. Pikeville Medical with tents up outside the hospital so they can triage people as they come in. Ephraim McDowell, you remember that testimonial from that nurse last week, having lost 7 patients over a weekend and not having enough morgue space for them? What does that do to you? Not just to live through, but to actually watch that space be overtaken. It is a very difficult and dangerous situation. And for those that need it to personally impact them, if you don't know somebody who's in the ER, in the hospital with COVID, first of all, you will. But second, if you're in a car accident today in most regions of the state, it's going to be a lot harder to get the help that you need. Or, God help us, your family. This is something we've all got to do. If you don't want to get vaccinated for any other reason, how about so the ER can help you out or your family out if you're the next person in that car wreck? Now, we are actively working as our hospitals to try to increase capacity out there. And let me say, hospitals converting space. St. Clair has converted numerous ORs to COVID wings, different groups trying to expand their ICUs. We are working with folks to make sure they have enough ventilators because the ventilator usage has popped up faster and more than we've ever seen. But we do believe that we are going to have enough. We just got to get them to the places that need them. So we're taking at least 3 efforts right now to increase our healthcare capacity. And I want to just briefly go over those. We have 7 strike teams of the National Guard. We're going to hear from the Guard on other efforts today. But these are strike teams that are going to be deployed September 1st. I believe they're going to be at, it's between 3 and 5 hospitals, helping to do anything and everything that frees up the medical staff at those hospitals to serve more patients and more boards. We've requested FEMA strike teams for understaffed hospitals. Remember, there were 2 parts of that request. Number 1, nurse strike teams. We're awaiting a decision on that. The second was we needed additional EMS strike teams. Not having enough ambulances and emergency personnel, first responders to transfer people between hospitals when they needed to, or to run regular emergency runs around counties because people are either out with COVID or there are that many people who are really sick and need help. So today we did get notice from FEMA, and we are grateful that they are sending us the EMS strike teams. Believe they'll arrive Friday in Lexington. They'll be here for 30 days, and it is 30 personnel with 15 ambulance vehicles. That is going to be a big help. We still need those nurse strike teams. Admittedly, so do a lot of other states. So do a lot of other states. But we are grateful for this extra help. We will take every single person, every single bit of help that we can get. And then the last piece, and this is something we actually came up with over the last 36 hours. I've been talking to a number of hospital CEOs and saying, tell me your challenges. And then I got to tell me your frustrations. And what they told me to a person was, our emergency rooms are overwhelmed. And we got people that show up there just to get a COVID test. Now, sometimes they're worried. Sometimes they've been exposed and you need a COVID test for that. Sometimes their kid's going to play in a baseball tournament the next weekend and you need a COVID test for that. While the emergency room is not the place to go for a COVID test, right? If you're not sick, don't go there. The reality is that people are. And that takes staff away from these hospitals that could otherwise be directly helping patients. So with several hard-hit hospitals, through contracts, we are going to take over the testing at that hospital, locate at or next to it, do all of those tests for the folks that are coming in, and thus free up extra capacity. The people from the hospital that are doing the testing right now can serve patients. So let's look at new COVID-19 community test sites. These are some of our hardest hit hospitals. We believe beginning this Friday, so we've moved fast. We briefed the legislature on this. We're going to be able to use CARES Act money for it. It's just necessary because we're in an emergency situation. We're going to be at Corbin. Wild Health is going to help us with that. They're going to be able to take over testing there. That's Baptist Health Corbin. Pikeville Medical Center, where they have the triage tents outside. We hope and pray this frees up some extra people. I heard from their CEO today. They are expanding their COVID capacity units for the third straight time. And their staff is getting hit by it too, because if you have that much COVID in the building, you're going to see that happen. Morehead, St. Clair, probably nobody hit harder. And then in Danville, separately, Gravity Diagnostics, one of our other partners, remember our original testing partner. This is how we built out testing in Kentucky. This was the first group that was there to truly help us. We went from not having a test to having a state lab that could run a few to scaling up with this company. This is one of the heroes of this pandemic. They're going to be helping us in Danville. This is to help out Ephraim McDowell and what they've been through. If this works, and if we have the money and the buy-in, this is something that we may look at expanding further. So we are going to continue to try to be creative. Listen, I get that there are some policy calls I can't make, but if I've got the ability to help out any hospital, have one extra person or one extra bed, that might be your family member, and we're going to keep working on it. Masking. As you all know, I put in an order, and thankfully the Kentucky Department of Education followed with an emergency regulation requiring masking in our public schools and our daycares. It's something the CDC says you absolutely have to do or you won't succeed, and a lot of people will get COVID. It is what the State Department of Public Health says you have to do or it won't work, and a lot of people will get COVID. It's what the Kentucky Chamber of Commerce says we have to do, or a whole lot of kids will be quarantined and their parents can't come to work, and we won't be able to fill out a shift. And it's exactly what we've seen in our schools. I'd take Warren County Public Schools. I know they probably don't like that I keep talking about them. They came in doing it wrong, masking optional, got up to about 1,400, more than JCPS, people quarantined. Then they turned around and did it right. And listen, it's a good thing. We're proud of them in making that decision. So they cut it in half in 2 weeks. Masking in schools works. Not masking in schools does not. There's already research on it. I talked about this a little bit last time, and we didn't have this up. This is school-level modeling results for North Carolina. This is something that NC State University with another university did and that the CDC has reviewed. Two huge findings. Number one, you don't universal mask in your schools. Their modeling shows that 90% of the kids are going to get infected by the end of just a semester. I'm a parent with a vaccinated and an unvaccinated child. I pulled out of an event this morning because I have an unvaccinated child, and this thing is burning through this state. With this result, you absolutely have to recognize that sending our kids into classrooms without masks means they're going to get COVID, or they're going to be darn lucky if they don't. And masks work. People tell you that masks don't work. That is misinformation that kills people and mainly just gives somebody an excuse because they don't like doing it. We all do a lot of things we don't like doing. It protects you. It protects the people around you. You have to wear a seatbelt in the car. You have to have car insurance. You can't drink and drive. You know, you could argue that those are limitations on your liberty, but guess what? They protect you and they protect other people, and we all do them. This is not a debate. It is a fact. that we've got to mask our kids in school or we will see bad results. You know, that decision on broader masking, on masking throughout the Commonwealth, is now one that's going to be left to the legislature. But yesterday, having the third highest number of cases we've ever had, and having more than 65 people die, that would have been the trigger for me, if it was in my authority, to have put in a masking order for indoors across the state. Every other time we've been this high, we've done that, and it's worked. It has decreased the number of cases. I can't do that now, and I get that, and I'll provide all the information that I can to the General Assembly, and hopefully they will make the best choice that they can. And I can't comment on what their choice will be. We need to get them the information, and then they can ultimately debate that. But I'm begging you out there, put on that mask. Put on that mask. You wore it when we were here before, and you're still here. And so are most of the people around you. We desperately need for you to do it again. All right, let's quickly go through some of our charts. We did this on Monday. Kentucky COVID-19 cases by, not that one yet, week. We are going to exceed last week. It is a precipitous rise. We are getting very close to exponential growth. That's really bad. What we're looking at is Philadelphia and not St. Louis. Positivity. Yeah, go to the positivity. Again, just as tough. Let's look at vaccination status. Actually, this has bounced around a little bit, but compared to last week, vaccinated individuals are doing better than what we had seen. We had seen more breakthroughs last week by these percentages. Just look at them. 90% of all cases and hospitalizations are among unvaccinated individuals, 9 out of 10. It tells you how powerful these vaccines are. Let's look at the rate of COVID-19 cases and vaccinations. This is how much a vaccine protects you. If there's that much more COVID out there, if it's more aggressive, yes, there are going to be some breakthrough cases. But look at the difference. The delta, if you will, between the, what color is that? Is that gray? I can ask one question to you all. Gray? Yep. The difference between the delta between the gray and the blue is how much better protected you are, vaccinated versus unvaccinated. Look at that. You are still as protected. You may be more protected. Y'all can do the division now than ever before. But if you also look at that size, it shows you how much more infection there is out there now than ever before. It should tell you that if you don't get the vaccine, you're going to get really, really sick. And we do not want that to happen. Inpatient census continues to go up. That looks like exponential growth. That's why our hospitals are bursting at the seams. Intensive care units continue to go up, exponential growth. Ventilator census, and this one, okay, go back one. Go back to the ICU. I'm going to use this to just show you why the ventilator is so concerning and the rate of its growth, because those are people who may not make it. You can see how there is a peak earlier on, you know, that's that December time frame in the ICUs, right? And that peak, now move it. For the ICUs, let's go to the ventilators. In many ways, was more pronounced here. And where we are now, ventilators versus where we were in the worst before, is more severe possibly than any other statistic, even though the numbers are lower. So what all that means is we got to do better. And we also have to lift up those that are in the hospital dealing with this devastation. We've seen their exhaustion. We've seen their trauma. So it's not just those that are regularly in a hospital that have fought this so hard and that are healthcare heroes during Healthcare Hero Appreciation Week. We also have our Kentucky National Guard and all the wonderful work that they have done to help protect us during this. We've been talking throughout the pandemic about how the Kentucky National Guard has been an incredible partner, supporting our COVID-19 response across the Commonwealth. In honor of Healthcare Heroes Appreciation Week, we're getting the chance to not only recognize some of our heroes in the medical field, but also those that serve in uniform. And many of them also serve in the medical field. With as much as we've asked of both our medical professionals and our guard over the last 18 months, I can only imagine how hard these folks must have worked. Since March of 2020, we've called on the National Guard to do a variety of jobs across the Commonwealth to help combat COVID-19. In particular, our military medical professionals have helped with drive-through testing services, mass vaccination centers, mobile vaccination teams, providing support to long-term health facilities when they're in crisis, and local health departments, as well as setting up and completely staffing our alternate care facility at the Louisville Fair and Expo Center last summer. Since the vaccine was pushed out, our medical guardsmen have distributed approximately 10,000 vaccinations among both the general public and our Department of Defense personnel here in the Commonwealth. At this time, I'd like to recognize some of our guardsmen who also serve in the medical community. So if our air guardsmen will come forward. I think first we have Major Angela Himmler, a registered nurse practitioner who works full-time for the National Guard. Then we have First Lieutenant Natasha Perry, also a registered nurse for our Norton healthcare system. And then we have Senior Master Sergeant Paul, is it Vogt?
Vogt.
Paul Vogt, Air Force medic and a cardiopulmonary technician at UK Hospital. If our Army Guardsmen will come forward to be recognized. Thank you all. Thank you. Great. Colonel Christopher Howell, who is also a PA for the Lexington VA Hospital. Thank you for that work. Captain TJ Shaddix,
yes,
a physician assistant for Eastern State Hospital. Thank you for that work. And Sergeant Alicia Schultz, an Army medic and ICU technician for St. Joe Healthcare System. Thank you. Thank you for all your work. My goodness. Thank you for stepping up every single time we need you. I hope you know this Commonwealth loves you and appreciates your service. Thank you. At this time, Colonel Chris Howell will fill us in on how they plan to support the state this fall as we dig into fighting this Delta variant running rampant through our communities.
Thank you, Governor Beshear. Appreciate that introduction, all that valuable information that you bestowed upon us. Appreciate that. Over the course of this pandemic, the soldiers and the airmen of the Kentucky National Guard have been instrumental in the fight against COVID, in supporting the Commonwealth and the health and well-being of its citizens. I believe that Kentucky's citizen soldiers have never been such an instrument of change, an instrument to prevent the illness and the loss of life throughout this state since the formation of the Kentucky National Guard in 1912. Since January, I have played a small part in a dynamic team that has brought the fight to this pandemic. These past 8 months have been particularly rewarding working with and for our fellow Kentuckians. Even after almost 34 years of service, I continue to be impressed every day with the intelligence, the compassion, the esprit de corps that these teams have. However, the previous and the future success of these teams are directly related to the support and the understanding of their employers. Here today, that you saw earlier, is just a small percentage of military individuals that have been on these teams. They came in, they engaged, they made positive impacts throughout the communities. Now they're back in their own private practices. They're back in their own hospitals. So all of these employers that have accommodated the Kentucky National Guard, I want to personally thank those employers, especially for the teams that were here today. As you heard, the VA Medical Center in Lexington, I work there. I love working there. UK Hospital, Eastern State Hospital, St. Joseph's Hospital, and Norton's Hospital. Thank you very much for your support in allowing and giving us the best that you have. To date, The Guard's support to the Commonwealth as it combats COVID has included mobile vaccination teams, as the governor mentioned, who have visited 79 communities in 14 counties throughout the state and have administered 3,100 vaccinations in these communities, in these mostly remote communities. They participated in mass COVID testing and vaccination sites, assisted in long-term healthcare facilities in local health departments. They partook in collection and distribution of 6,448 tons of food and supplies. Also with other agencies like the Hope Center in Lexington and three other organizations in Northern Kentucky and Elizabethtown, they have delivered 104,000 meals to those in Kentucky who needed it. At Boone National Guard Center here in Frankfort, the Window H Ford Regional Training Center in Greenville, and the Air Wing in Louisville, the soldiers and the airmen in these teams have given over 6,400 vaccinations to soldiers, to airmen, to retirees, dependents, and DOD contractors. Most of what I have mentioned have been tangible items and statistics. I believe the intangible aspects of what the soldiers and airmen have brought to the Commonwealth is equally as important. The soldiers and airmen have brought compassion, they have brought respect, and they have brought hope to those who need it. Moving forward, as the governor mentioned, the initial plan was to reduce the role of the military by September 30th. However, as we all know, with the Delta variant and the amount that it is negatively impacting this state, we are going to be on orders until at least December 30th, if not beyond that. During this time, the teams will continue to do what I mentioned earlier. However, we will have a larger impact in schools, in universities, Department of Corrections. We have been notified and requested by hospitals throughout the state for administrative and logistical support. So that is something that we hold dearly, reaching out there and helping our fellow citizens. The beauty of the military is our ability to adapt and overcome. And we will do just that over the course of the next several months. In closing, I stand in front of you today as a man who grew up in the knobs and hollers of LaRue and Nelson County. I fished in Knob Creek. I hunted in the woods close to Abraham Lincoln's birthplace. I am a Kentucky boy through and through, and I am honored to serve our state. As a medical provider and military officer, I want to thank Governor Beshear, Dr. Peck, and General Lamberton for entrusting us, these team members, in the care of the citizens of this beautiful state. I also want to encourage those who have not been vaccinated to please get vaccinated. Please. It works, it's effective, and it will save your life, and it will save your family's life. Wear the mask, social distance. We all know what to do. We have got to continue to follow the golden rule. Treat others the way you want to be treated. Within the Kentucky Army National Guard, there's a saying that's been passed down since the 1800s, and that is fight as Kentuckians. As a unified front, let us all fight as Kentuckians against COVID. Maintain our respect for one another, follow the golden rule, and end this pandemic together. Thank you.
I'm going to admit I made a mistake today. We should have started with the Colonel. My goodness. I got a second wind. You're pretty good at that thing. Now, thank you, Colonel, but also thank you to all of your people that I know stand with you and behind you. Today, we want you all to be recognized as one of our two Team Kentucky All-Stars that we try to recognize for their service. Again, we've called upon you more than probably any other governor has ever had to, and you answer the call and do an incredible job each time. Our other Team Kentucky All-Stars today, after 18 months of our war against COVID, our healthcare heroes we know are tired, they're frustrated, they're fatigued, but they're working harder than ever. And our hospitals are caring for patients, many of whom are younger and sicker than before. And our long-term care facilities, they're caring for some of our most vulnerable patients in a setting where the virus can spread, especially quickly, devastating these communities. These healthcare workers know firsthand, maybe better than anyone, that these vaccines work, and that's why so many of them have rolled up their sleeves to protect themselves and their patients. Let's show the healthcare slide, the long-term care slide. According to the most recent study from the CDC's National Safety Network, the facilities shown here are reporting at least 90% of residents and 80% of staff fully vaccinated. That makes them, for their specific local work, Team Kentucky All-Stars. And look at the Transitional Care Center in Owensboro. 100% of their residents, 100% of their staff fully vaccinated. That's outstanding. We got a lot of All-Stars, but this is probably our scoring leader. Truly a wonderful job. You look right behind them, the Episcopal Church home in Louisville, Willows at Fritz Farm in Lexington. This really shows you that it's leadership, it's not location, and a state facility, and a state veterans facility, which we are very proud of. The Carl M. Beshear, different veterans center in Radcliffe. Again, look at London, the Laurel Heights home, and Louisa, the Jordan Center, and Essex Nursing and Rehab. Folks, this shows us that the amount of individuals vaccinated in any organization or entity has to do with the strength of the leadership and how hard they work and how hard they push. So to these facilities, thank you for your incredible work. People are safer because of you. Speaking of vaccines, yesterday, like I said, was a tough day. We had 4,800 COVID cases, and we had less than 4,000 vaccinations during that day. First time I can remember it was inverted in that way. Today, 6,674 new vaccinations. We thank God for that. Now our number of Kentuckians, at least one shot of hope, 2,488,328. We will see as we move forward if we're truly in a continuing uptick or whether we have increased, which is good, but then plateaued. Again, if that means there are more people consistently getting it, that would be a good thing. But to fight the Delta variant, we need a lot more than 6,000 people being vaccinated each day. Let's remember, we can defeat the deadliest thing we've ever seen by going to the drugstore or the grocery store or your local health department or calling any of them. And I'm pretty positive they'll come to you and getting vaccinated. The means of victory are right in front of us and they're safe, fully FDA approved, and half the country has already taken them. You'd know if there was a real issue with them. All right, so that's the first part of our Team Kentucky update. It is the hard part. Now, let's look at some hope. While this is a time of difficulty and tragedy, it is also a time of hope and promise. And it's really hard emotionally that both are going on in the same time. It's really hard to process, but our economy is taking off in a phenomenal way. And I think it's important for people to see and recognize that too, because dealing with the variant means we can get to this prosperity faster. So let's start with Thoroughbred Aviation Management. Yesterday, Rocky Atkins, my senior advisor here in the governor's office, joined Thoroughbred Aviation Maintenance to help cut the ribbon on the company's new consolidated headquarters at the Bluegrass Airport in Lexington. The project will create 47 full-time jobs over the next 3 years and improve the company's ability to service all inbound and departing commercial flights in Lexington. Thoroughbred's been growing since 1988, and it's great to see that growth is continuing. I'd like to congratulate my friend Todd Case on that one. This morning, I had the opportunity to join James E. Pepper Distilling Company and its owner, Amir Pei, to break ground on the distiller's first barrel warehouse, a $3 million investment in Midway. That activity, an outdoor activity, I appreciate them doing in a safe way because there are still safe ways that we can get together. Amir is breathing new life into this iconic brand after 50 years off the market. In 2017, he rebuilt this historic operation in Lexington's distillery district, and today's groundbreaking shows it is another step forward. Keep an eye out. Pepper products hitting the shelves, at least right now, three different brands or bourbons. At least the one we tasted today was delicious. Chapin International, company growing at an amazing pace here in Kentucky. Last September, we announced its first Kentucky facility in Mount Vernon. But here we are, less than a year later, even in the midst of the pandemic, with the company moving forward with not one, but two new projects in our state. Chapin, which makes compressed air sprayers, is adding 100 additional jobs in Rockcastle County, doubling the planned job creation there. Chapin is also locating a second Kentucky facility in Danville, a nearly 500,000 square foot facility that employ another 100 Kentuckians. That's 200 new jobs with nearly $16.7 million in new investment. And Chapin made sure that we could see their product today. We thought we'd get one that said Team Kentucky, but then we thought someone might object and file something on that one again. Never thought I'd be standing up here with the sprayer, but it is a good sprayer made right here in Kentucky, supporting Kentucky jobs. And from a guy who started work mucking stalls and then weed eating, those sprayers can be incredibly helpful. Bigelow Tea. A lot of y'all have this at home. Next up is Bigelow Tea, which is relocating and expanding in Jeffersontown. This $53 million investment, creating 31 quality jobs in Jefferson County and helping grow our state's food, beverage, and agritech sector. Bigelow's operated in Jeffersontown for nearly three decades. I'll admit I didn't know that. I've had their tea, and I didn't know that this is a Kentucky company. Construction on the new facility on Blankenbaker Road is scheduled to begin this coming spring, and I look forward to the facility opening in summer 2024. I don't always drink tea, but when I do, it's Bigelow Tea. And that's not the only great announcement in Jefferson County today. Affordable housing developer LDG Multifamily is growing its presence in Louisville with a $10.75 million investment that's going to create 50 high-wage jobs at an average salary of $49 an hour, including benefits. It's our goal to create good-paying jobs for all Kentuckians, and companies like this are helping to make that a reality. I'm also a fan of their philosophy. They say, quote, everyone deserves a quality place to live. Isn't that Kentucky? Place that we love, our sense of home. It's a great message, a great foundation. We couldn't be happier to have this amazing company with this amazing culture growing. Finally, again, there's a lot of good news out there. It's just sometimes hard to see it in the midst of the darkness. And another step that moves Kentucky's automotive industry further into the electrified future, Toyota announced that it'll assemble hydrogen fuel cell modules at its plant in Georgetown beginning this year. These hydrogen fuel cell modules will be available to heavy-duty commercial truck makers, allowing the big rig industry an emission-free option. Think about that. Biggest trucks on the road, emission-free, something that will make us not only more efficient, but what an amazing impact that'll have positively on our environment. This is great news for Kentucky, and it's a sure sign of more electric vehicle-related manufacturing to come. Remember, we announced 250 new jobs in Whitley County for Firestone in that same electric vehicle-related market. Listen, we're at the center of the U.S. automotive manufacturing corridor. We provide a prime location to anyone in currently manufacturing or looking at the manufacturing of the future of either the batteries or the vehicles. We got 500 plus automotive facilities statewide and a skilled workforce that's been doing this for generation after generation. We believe that we can make anybody out there in the automotive sector successful. And Team Kentucky would like to thank Toyota for continuing to invest in the future of automotive electrification, as well as in Georgetown, and as well as our Kentucky workforce. Even with the challenges that we have faced, we have an economy that is on fire. More opportunity at higher wages. We've already surpassed last year in both jobs created and total investment. And I think we could double from where we are right now by the end of the year. We are at a cusp of incredible prosperity, something we all deserve after the last 18 months, but we got to get there. So you want a bright future? You want better jobs, better wages? Be a part of industries of the future: aerospace, agriculture, technology, electric vehicles. Get your vaccine. Finally, we got a couple of major critical projects we got to get done across this Commonwealth so that everybody has infrastructure that can allow for entire regions to open up. Three that that come to mind are the Brent Spence Bridge in Northern Kentucky, with the amount of GDP of the country that crosses it every day. The I-69 corridor, the bridge we need to build, and we will build, that'll connect Indiana to Kentucky right at Henderson. And the Mountain Parkway expansion. It is absolutely critical that we get that thing four lanes from where it starts all the way to Prestonsburg. And Rocky and I were proud to be in Morgan County on Tuesday to celebrate another milestone in the expansion of that parkway. Eastern Kentucky is open for business. We're joined by transportation officials, state legislators. I think we had John Blanton and Philip Wheeler, and local officials to celebrate the opening of 8 miles of the parkway that's been widened to four lanes in Morgan County and parts of Wolf and Magoffin County. Expanding the Mountain Parkway is going to open up communities to types of manufacturing and other opportunities that always said we've got to have a four-lane road. But this stretch is also one of the most dangerous in Kentucky, and it won't be any longer. I never forget that when we look at a road, it's not just economic development. It's not just progress. It's safety. It's putting our kids in that car every day and wanting them to be on the safest roads possible. So we are going to continue our economic development efforts. And Jim Gray has the biggest pair of scissors in that picture that I have ever seen. So with that, we will open it up to questions. I know we've been running long, but we'll take the amount of time that it takes. Today, we got three members of the press in person, a number of others virtually. And let me say, I do appreciate the willingness to have fewer people in the room and more virtually. That's setting a really good example for what we need to see across the Commonwealth. And let me just talk about that example. We're in a tough place. We need to be wearing masks, and we all need to think about our personal schedule. I am not going to be at large indoor events in the near future when things are this hot. And I hope others will look at those big events coming up and figure out, if they are indoors, how to make them safer, how to make them smaller, how to make them virtual, how to push them outside. It is that dangerous right now, to where we need people to take that personal responsibility to make good decisions. And remember, if there are unvaccinated people in your life, people that aren't old enough to be vaccinated, that you know, that you love, and that you care about, you got to make sure that you're doing as many right things as you can to protect them. Because if you're vaccinated, you can still get this Delta variant, and you can still spread it. So everybody, please be careful. Make good decisions. I know I'll always put the safety of my family first. Tom Latek, Kentucky Today.
Thanks, Governor. In lieu of, as you call it, hot, and the recent Supreme Court decision, how close are you to putting something together that you can present to the General Assembly and call a special session?
So the majority leadership of the House and the Senate, I've met with both over the last couple days. We have presented them with all of the order steps, procedures, if you will, that are currently in place, not that need to be in place. We'll have those conversations too, so that they see what happens if the state of emergency is allowed to expire. So the legislature's new job under their new legislation is to come in and to extend the state of emergency, or if they choose not to, all those steps go away and possibly FEMA funding. But we believe right now the president's order, all 50 states, protects that. So right now they have in hand a whole list of different things that we need, things like workers' compensation for our frontline workers if they get COVID. I mean, my goodness, we got to provide that. Things like recognizing doctors licensed in other states so that we can help increase our healthcare capacity. And they're taking a close look at it, and I do believe they're analyzing it. I hope that we'll get the feedback soon, that they're ready to go. But listen, there are those that think, you know, I should immediately call them in and say, here's the ball, good luck. And that's not right. Listen, we need to succeed in this thing, and I've still got to carry it out once they've gotten in. So I'm trying to do this in a way, because we got some time before the state of emergency would expire, because we got some time before the injunction goes away. I'm trying to give us our best chance of success. And I always told everybody that to me, this wasn't about wins and losses. It's about life and death. Guess what? I got to prove it. And I am going to prove it. Austin Pollock.
One of the things that you've talked a good bit about is stop spreading misinformation. You see it on social media. You see people say masks don't work. You see people say that, you know, you can still get COVID, which you still can. But aside from stop, you know, spreading misinformation, what else can people be told aside from just, you know, stop?
Those spreading misinformation?
Yep.
You know, I think those spreading misinformation, as opposed to just me saying stop, ought to watch the videos or even talk to the individuals, these family members that have watched people pass away. Community members, coaches, you know, people that they may or may not have known, but talk to those individuals. Talk to Ethan from one of our previous videos who said, I believed it. I got into it. I even made the posts. And Ethan still isn't fully better and barely survived. You know, if you're spreading misinformation that kills people, I think the very least that you can do is talk to some of the family members that have died because of it. Look them in the eye and tell them that COVID's not real. It's amazing. I mean, it's amazing that people being willing to distort the truth or flat out lie on Facebook can cause so much damage. And then it admittedly is so hard to combat. You know, I hope they talk to their ministers, whether what they're doing is right, because it's not. It's not being our brother and sister's keeper or living by that golden rule. But if any of us had the silver bullet on battling misinformation, we'd all do it. I know. Gladys.
Governor, so when you talk about hospitalizations, those numbers, they don't look like they're getting any better. Mm-hmm. When you talk about bringing out the National Guard, what are you hoping comes of that?
So the National Guard, originally there'll be 7 teams. We may staff up to 14 teams. What they're going to do is go into the hospital and try to take over any non-medical function that frees up medical personnel and or fill in when folks are sick with COVID and out. I mean, if you don't have food service, then people don't survive. In the hospital. You know, our guard units are creative. They adapt what we heard. And I know they're going to be a big help. And the hospitals that they are going to are overjoyed. I got a text from Pikeville Medical, and they are thrilled, even though they are overwhelmed. You could see when we talked to St. Clair the other day that it gave them hope. You had two, a doctor and a nurse, who are hurting because of where they are. And they high-fived in the midst of talking about all that hurt. Between that and trying to take over the testing, we hope that creates more capacity, because we're not worried about the number of physical beds. We have more physical beds than we can staff. And so on any given day, when we look at how many ICUs do we have, well, how many people showed up to work that day? How many are quarantined? How many of them have the skills and the training? And it's not just in our bigger hospitals. It's also our smaller hospitals that are treating sicker patients than they've ever treated before. You know, we have some of these regional hospitals that they help, they stabilize people, and if they're really hurt, they get them out, and they can't get them out now. I mean, think about people on ventilators in a place that doesn't have an ICU. So our hope is to free up as much capacity as we can. And I do think it'll help, but it's not going to fix the issue. Vaccinations is the only thing that will.
And the National Guard, they're on call until at least December. I mean, are you anticipating the situation to potentially get worse, considering whether it's going to be cold outside, more people going to be indoors? Is that a real concern for you?
So the National Guard will be on until December 30th, because that's as long as federal funding has been extended right now. So that's really what that date is. We will see. You know, when we look back about Philadelphia versus St. Louis, remember, it went up and up and up and up and up really fast in Philadelphia, but then it burned so hot it came back down. And so we really have to watch this as it goes. No one's seen the peak yet. We thought we had in Florida. We thought it was slowing down, and then it sped back up again. So one of the frightening things is we don't know how high that goes. Stu Johnson from WEKU.
Yes, thank you, Governor. You mentioned earlier in your brief that if it was your call, you would have the indoor masking put in place right now. Is the only way that indoor masking could be made mandatory would be by a vote of the General Assembly?
Yes. That is my belief, that it would take a vote of the General Assembly. And certainly with what the law is now, for and I'm not talking about schools, I'm talking about the overall requirement that people wear masks. Yes, would take a vote of the General Assembly. I don't have the authority to do that now without them. Sarah Ladd, the Courier-Journal.
Yes, thank you. Are you aware of any Kentucky hospitals that, for whatever reason, staffing shortages or an increase of patients, have had to keep COVID positive staff or staff who otherwise should be in quarantine on floors working, or hospitals that are facing that possibility soon? Thanks.
Sarah, I am not aware of any. That doesn't mean it may or may not have happened. What I hear about more is staffing shortages due to COVID exposure, and that is increasing. And you got to think, the more COVID patients in a hospital, just the more potential infection, and thus the place where the staff is needed the most is the most likely place where you lose staff because of infection, breakthrough, or otherwise. But I'm not personally aware of any group having to do that yet. Josh James, WUKY. Okay, we'll come back to Josh. Kelly Dean, WBKO.
Hi, Governor. So a local lawmaker told me this morning that people who are from rural areas like Edmonton County, now if they go to Warren County for a vaccine, they ultimately get counted into that Warren County's vaccination rate. So are the vaccination rates inaccurate, or should we rely more on the state's overall vaccine rate?
So when you go to get vaccinated, you fill out that form, and I think it ultimately breaks down by zip code. So if you put down your zip code and your county of not origin, where you live, then it gets counted in there. There are a couple of places where a zip code is in multiple counties, and their overall percentage may be off some. It wouldn't be off a ton. Spencer County is one of those. There is a zip code there, and I believe the people in that zip code who get vaccinated who might live in Spencer County have been counted in another county, because right now we don't have the ability to parse it out, but I know they're working on it. That's a federal issue. Christian County, which is one of the lowest in the state, doesn't include folks at Fort Campbell that have been vaccinated, because they don't give us that information. So the data is by no means perfect, but it's not going to be off by that much either. You know, a county's not going to be 70% without having a ton of people vaccinated. Same way, it's not going to be at 20% without the large majority of people not being vaccinated. Jose Neil Donis from Aldea.
Thank you, Governor. How successful do you think has been the Shot at a Million campaign? And what other initiatives or measures are being contemplated in the next 6 months to encourage people to get vaccinated?
So tomorrow, we're going to unveil our last millionaire in the Shot at a Million contest, as well as five additional kids who win that golden ticket to a free higher education. We believe it has been successful, but let me explain what I think that it did. We were drastically seeing our vaccinations fall, and the rate was precipitous, almost straight down. If you think about those line charts, when we announced Shot at a Million, it stabilized, right? Otherwise, we believe fewer and fewer and fewer people would. So, you know, did it increase vaccinations? Well, if you compare to where the modeling suggested, or the line suggested where it would have gone, then yes. But what I would say is it stabilized. It got us to a place that wasn't nearly enough, but at least it was a steady amount of people getting vaccinated. It never went to zero. In fact, it was always in the thousands. What I think we're seeing is it takes something like the severity of the Delta variant to increase vaccinations. It takes requirements from employers. That's absolutely increasing vaccinations out there. I hope that full FDA approval for Pfizer helps some that are skeptical, but not, you know, politically opposed, if you will, to get it. We are doing some other things. Look at the state fair. If you go get vaccinated there, you can get a $30 wristband to ride any ride that you want, a $20 gift card. If you're a WellCare member, a $100 gift card. Just about all of our Medicaid managed care companies are offering $100 or more to individuals to get vaccinated. Kentucky Tourism has drawings right now if you get vaccinated for all types of things, including a staycation, a ton of golf, a ton of their wonderful experiences, lodging, and campground stays at Kentucky State Parks. We've offered a free day off, paid day off, I guess is the way you would say it, for all of our state employees if they will get vaccinated. We did sporting events where you get a free ticket. We appreciate those two soccer organizations in Louisville. That'd be Louisville Racing FC, as well as their connected team, which and then local health departments have been doing all types of things. Frankfurt Health Department did come in to get a vaccine. They had a huge amount of pizza, and they just hand you one and anything else that they can do. We continue to try to use trusted messengers. That's Ethan, remember, talking about how he wished he'd gotten vaccinated and how he'd been skeptical. Brittany and I got vaccinated in the rotunda with other lots of other people. We had all those faith leaders come through. We've been hosting vaccine clinics at churches, at community centers in disadvantaged areas. Now, PSAs and the rest, we need to figure out new strategies, no question. And we're all looking for any and everything we can do. The other thing that we have to do is reuse some of these strategies when booster shots, third shots, let me say, become available. So right now, anybody who's immunocompromised can go in and get a booster shot. And all of our nursing homes, the individuals are going to get them. That's different than if you're not immunocompromised, like me. You can get your third shot starting September 20th. 8 months after your second shot. And we're going to know when your second shot was. So it has to be 8 months after. We're going to have to make sure that all those things that we were able to successfully turn people out, especially in difficult to reach communities, to get shot one and two, we do for shot three. But really important when we talk about it, to always make sure we're talking about there being a difference for immunocompromised people who can go get it right now, and those that are going to get it in the regular course, just like everybody else. Melissa Patrick, Kentucky Health News.
Hi, Governor. Is it a blanket Department of Public Health order to allow COVID-19 positive staff without symptoms to work on COVID units? Or do hospitals have to make that request from the Department of Public Health? And do you have any idea how many hospitals have simply made that request to have that policy put in place for their hospital, if that's the case?
So, Melissa, we don't have Dr. Stack today, but we will get you that directly from him. I want to make sure we get it accurately. I have not seen a request, but I'm not sure I would necessarily see that request. I mean, this is what Dr. Stack does and does so well. So we will get you accurate information on that just as quickly as we can. Jess Clark from WFPL.
Hello, Governor. So you say a vote in the legislature is the only way that we can create a statewide indoor mask mandate. But what's stopping you from issuing a 30-day indoor mask mandate under this Supreme Court ruling? I think the ruling says that you can, issue, or the law says you can issue a mandate for 30 days. What's stopping you from doing that? And then by the same token, what's stopping the Department of Public Health from issuing a statewide mandate?
So what the law says is I can declare a state of emergency that can last for 30 days. And at that point, and I can do certain things in that. But at that point, I've got to call the legislature in. What those laws also say is the state of emergency for COVID that's currently in place applies to any variant that comes thereafter. And that has already been in place more than 30 days, and it expires whenever the Franklin Circuit Court injunction expires. So I don't get to say I'm going to do another 30 days or a new 30 days or any order for 30 days. It's all dependent on the state of emergency. That's what starts it. That's what triggers the power. And that's what the Supreme Court even talked about when it expired, because while the injunction is keeping in place for the moment, it has to be dissolved here shortly. And the Supreme Court even talked about the date, which is now in the past, that the state of emergency expired. So listen, if I am granted the authority to do it for 30 days, it's just necessary right now. And we have far too many really big gatherings of people not wearing masks that we need to do so much better. And it shouldn't take an order on masks to get people to follow the rules and wear them. But when we do, when that order comes out, more people wear them. It just happens, right? And so I know some people push back, but more people wear them. And so they're not perfect, but they certainly help. Joe Ragusa from Spectrum.
Hi, Governor. So I want to ask about the nature of the emergency declaration in Franklin Circuit Court, because I believe there was a court hearing today where you and lawyers for the GOP asked for another 10 days to kind of negotiate a plan. I want to verify with you, where does the emergency order kind of stand in Franklin Circuit Court in light of today's hearing? And also that 10 days, do you feel like that's enough time to negotiate a plan that you guys can agree on and go to a special session with?
So the emergency, the state of emergency is still in effect because leaders of the legislature and I agree that there ought to be enough time so these things we need don't expire for them to try to come to a consensus for what they're willing to do. And by the way, I think that was a really responsible decision by them. They could have chosen to do something else, and that gives me hope about decisions coming out. And I think that was the first tough one where it might not please everybody out there, but it was the right one. So there's a couple different clocks that run. One is 20 days from the Supreme Court order that the decision doesn't take effect and push down on the Franklin Circuit Court, because that's the time that you can file for rehearing. So that's what it takes for it to become final. And then the Supreme Court, then the Franklin Circuit Court would have to dissolve the injunction, which get rid of the state of emergency, which impacts, about 100 different things we've put into place, most of which I don't think are controversial that help us fight this pandemic. So I think as long as we're working together and everybody agrees that they want at least the status quo that's going on right now to stay, that we may have a little more time than just 10 days. But I think Judge Shepard wants to know that we are working, and we are working. We're trying to figure out what type of information daily that they want. We've shown different reports. We've walked through them. And I believe that both the House and the Senate are actively looking at it. All right. We went really, really long today. I don't remember the last time we did. Thank you to our National Guard, who even stuck it out all the way through the end, which you all always do. Finish strong. Thank you to everybody from these hospital systems that are willing to be raw, emotional, and share what you're going through. We're at an unprecedented time that we've never seen before, and a time that could be the most difficult and devastating in the course of this pandemic. We can win. We can win tomorrow. We need you to get vaccinated. We'll get through this. We'll get through this together, and we'll give you another update on Monday.